involved with your footwear. When it comes to things like serving, for example, a lot of people cannot backhand serve. They'll put it in the net, or they'll put it this high up the net, and the player on the other side attacks it. So there's a big, big learning curve in doing that. And there's ways and ways of improving how you serve forehand or backhand. You know, essentially, the object of a low backhand serve is the shuttle comes over the net very low and goes towards the service line. And you're forcing, or trying to force, your opponent to lift it so that then you attack it. Doesn't always work because you get people who do fancy shots at the net from a low serve. But if your low serve's not good enough and it drops, goes over the net but drops short, you just lost the point. So it's quite critical. The serve is very critical. Most games, from the start of the serve, 3-4 shots and the round is over. Most games. Unless you get up to the grid on the top flight, you may know exactly where the shuttle is going. You know, I use the analogies a bit like chess. You know, you make one move and someone else makes
that. That's like I said.
And then another move goes.
That's like I said.
You know, and it's a bit like that. And it's knowing, as I said earlier, if I punch a shuttle into the rear court, I have to know why I've done it. If I did that into a left-handed player, wow, it's on their forehand. But if I did that with a right-handed player, the player's in the box and running around the shuttle, which means their foot works, not right, they've got a problem. Or they get backhand. Now, if you've got a strong backhand, great. A lot of players I know have got very strong backhands. They'll get backhand from the rear court back here. But the shuttle's up in the air again. And that player on this end can then play a drop, cross court, slice, smash. So again, all you're doing is you're working your opponents around the court, trying to get them out of position all the time. The bit I said about earlier, when you're defending, you look at players, they'll be defending the shot that's high in the opposite court. They're waiting for a smash. And as soon as, say, someone plays a drop shot, one player will go in to cover the net, and the other player will simply come behind it. And you're going to what's called an attacking mode. There's two modes. Defensive mode, attacking mode. Attacking mode is when you've got a player in the forecourt and you're hitting down. Defensive mode is when you spill. There is lots and lots of drills you can do. But they all take time. You won't change overnight. You won't do it. I mean, what was good is just watching you. The first thing I look for is, apart from footwork, is how you hold the racket. At the moment, you look at what we call the hand handle. It's that sort of thing. Rather than my shoulders and gets in through. But people get away with hand handle. They get away with it. It happens. It's a great shot at the net, that sort of shot at the net. If you get it, most you'll see a lot of ladies tend to use that kind of shot. But it's really being in control of your racket face and where you want to put the shot is what matters. You know? So, you know, I can do a bone net shot, play a J shot, tumbling shot, or I can rip it across court. You know, that's when I try to catch you in that corner.
Yeah.
Right? Because I wanted you over there. I wanted you to bypass Newark at forecourt. So I just whipped it straight into that backhand corner, which means you've got to travel along the back of the court. And the chances are you will hit it on your back, which is what you did.
Yeah.
But that's a tactical move. That's tactical. That's an order for it. But if you're prepared with it, prepare for it, people will get in. And they get in a position where they know, oh, it comes a backhand and they can go around the
head. And it would obviously, more modern practice, the muscle memory of
They used to say, practice makes perfect. So practice makes more permanent. The more and more you practice doing that thing, the more it becomes permanent in your game. It doesn't come perfect, no one's perfect. If we were all super duper players, no one would win, you know. Usually at the level you're playing, it's usually won and lost on an error. You might get the odd winning smash, but if you come up against some sort of experienced players, they'll expect, you probably didn't notice, but when I asked you to smash a nerd, I went further down the pool. So I knew, I knew that if I went further up the pool towards the net, that smash would go straight at me. But if I go further down the pool, I've got time to keep my racket out in front of me, and I've got time to see the shuttle, and I can do something with it. There are a lot of fundamental things you have to try and get into your game. As long as you enjoy it, that's the main thing, enjoy it. Learn, you know.
Yeah, we're doing it for enjoyment, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, it's great. It's a pity that you can't put a team in the local league. I mean, a lot of the clubs, that's Westfield, still local. They're up here. Leeway play up here. There's three clubs that play up here.
Maybe next year.
We
want to learn this year, and then you make us perfect, and then next year maybe.
I go to clubs, not so much now because COVID has affected it, obviously. I go to clubs where I watch four players on there, and then we'll pick it apart, basically. Or at least say, yeah, that was good, but you hit a lovely smash, but still looked at it. And then always have a player on the other side just go, the next level.
Another thing that I think, that's my thoughts, is that I have no other coaching or anything, but I'm playing there with my childhood anyway.
Yeah.
Where I grew up, all the different junior first sports. Yeah. Competition was very
good.
When the opponent starts, I choose the empty place.
Yeah.
Look for the gap.
Yeah.
Not for the person. If he's giving me ball, I'm going to try to carve the ball to left, right, whatever the empty place is available.
Because what you're doing is making a move.
Yes. Yeah.
If I leave a space, you're going to get the shuttle into that space. Because it then makes one of you move to that space. Mm-hmm. But as soon as you move to that space, you create a space somewhere else. You know, if you're standing here and one goes into the court there,
yeah,
a big space at the back here.
Yeah.
Now the opposing pair will look at you and go, right, I'm going to put you in that court and make that play.
Yeah.
So it is, a game of cat and mouse, moving your opponent around all the time.
Making them tired as well, you know what I mean?
There's some great training exercises that I do, mainly with the juniors, and that is sort of semi-fitness work. And I mean, my son's a PT, and he helped me out, and he does the fitness side. But we do these simple, they're called shuttle runs. They're very, very simple. But boy, does it highlight a lot of things about people's understanding of what badminton is all about. A lot of players, they see this net, and I'll just whack it over the net, without any sort of thought about what it's going to be like, So it's not great. I mean, I've been playing and coaching for a long time. It's nearly 40. I've been playing and coaching nearly 40 years. My oldest son's 39 this year.